Biomass pelleting on the farm is an opportunity to produce a densified value-added material. Now, there are a variety of different feedstocks that could be used to produce pellets. Which one is right for you? Let's take a look at three important considerations. First, availability. What do you have on the farm already that could be used as a feedstock for producing pellets? Do you have an excess of crop residue? Do you have a field of switchgrass or some other warm season grass that's not being put to use? Maybe you have a woodlot on the farm. Second, equipment. Now, farming equipment is typically very expensive if you have to buy it new. So if you can take and utilize what you already have on hand in your pelleting operation, you're going to be much better off. Three, the end use of the pellets. Biomass pellets can be used for a variety of different purposes, and your feedstock can impact how well they perform for that end use. Wood-based pellets tend to have a lower ash content and work better in pellet stoves for heating homes. Grass-based pellets, however, have a higher ash content and they're not as attractive for that purpose. They have other uses instead. Now, if you can find a situation where those three considerations line up, where you have a readily available feedstock, where you have equipment and facilities on hand, and you have an end use for those pellets, then you have a really nice scenario for producing biomass pellets on the farm. Now let's take a look at some examples of possible feedstocks you could use to produce pellets on the farm, including forest thinnings, perennial grasses, short rotation woody crops, and crop residues. Forest thinnings. Now, a lot of farms have a woodlot, and many of those woodlots are overgrown, and they really would benefit from a thinning or a timber stand improvement operation to allow the higher quality and the more desirable trees to grow better, for the forest to be healthier. And when you do that, you end up taking a lot of woody material out of the forest. That wood is usually not of a size and quality that makes it suitable for timber use. However, it can be used to make pellets. Now, if you remove the bark from the wood before you make pellets, those pellets are going to have a pretty low ash content, less than 1%. And the energy content is going to be up around 20 megajoules per kilogram. And that's exactly what you see in commercial grade pellets that are sold at the store. Perennial grasses. Now, perennial warm season grasses, like for example switchgrass, they've long been touted as being able to grow well on poor land or marginal soils, needing very few inputs, providing a lot of ecosystem services and benefits, and then also producing a high yield of material. However, those grasses typically aren't very suitable for animal feed, for example. So, what are you going to use them for? Well, you can use them to make pellets. Pellets made from switchgrass and other warm season grasses tend to have a higher ash content than wood pellets, though, so they're not always as attractive for putting in pellet stoves for home heating and those kinds of applications. However, switchgrass especially is very well known for its water absorbing capacity, and so absorption, spill cleanup, and other sorbent applications are often real good markets for grass-based pellets. Short rotation woody crops. Shrub willow and poplar are two examples of short rotation woody crops, fast-growing trees that can be planted in tightly spaced rows. You then harvest them once every 2 to 3 years and utilize the wood that you harvest. The plants then regrow after they've been harvested, so you get multiple cycles of growing and harvesting from one planting operation. Now, one thing to keep in mind with short rotation woody crops is they typically require specialized equipment, and you're going to need to check to see if that harvesting equipment is available in your region. Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. Crop residue. Crop residue is what's left over after you've harvested your oats, your corn, your soy, that kind of thing. Basically, it's the straw, the wheat straw, the oat straw, the corn stover. That material doesn't always have a market, but it can be used to produce pellets. And those pellets that you make from crop residues often have very similar properties to pellets made from grasses like switchgrass. So they'll tend to have a little bit of a higher ash content, but they also have good absorbent capacity. And so they can be used for a variety of purposes similar to the switchgrass-based pellets. So, what have we learned? Well, we've found that there are three main considerations to keep in mind when looking at a possible feedstock for pelleting on the farm: availability, equipment, and end use of those pellets. We've also taken a look at four different examples of possible feedstocks that can be used to produce pellets on the farm. Now that you have that information in hand, I think you'll be well on your way towards determining what's the right feedstock for you to use to produce pellets on your farm.